Everybody, welcome back to our YouTube channel, Miss Young Homeowner. So excited to be here today with Mr. Daniel Walcott as our guest speaker.
Happy to be here.
Thank you for taking the time out of your weekend to join us.
You're welcome.
And thank you for showing us this beautiful home.
Yes, absolutely. Thanks for coming by.
Yeah, so we are currently sitting in one of his listings in DC. Correct. It's beautiful. But just want to jump in and kind of get to know you a little bit.
Sure.
So can you tell us a little bit about yourself? Who are you? Where you're from? All those good things.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm originally from Long Island, New York.
Okay.
I came to DC about 10 years ago now, back in 2009, where I went to Howard University.
The other
so,
two.
Shout out to my bison.
Let that be known.
So I came to DC to go to school in 2009 and just never left, right? So I warmed up to the city. I love DC now, so
good.
It's sort of my home, and that's just how I got here. As far as real estate, that journey started a little over 3 years ago.
Okay.
I was working full time as a sales and marketing coordinator for a company called Living Social,
mm-hmm.
and someone had reached out and wanted to run a promotion for their real estate courses, and so I helped them set up. We've gotten to know each other pretty well, and I thought it was just a great deal. So I asked him, hey, can I buy it and take it? And he sort of became my early real estate mentor. So I took that class, the class that everybody has to take in order to get their real estate mm-hmm. license, passed, and then quit my full-time job and jumped into real estate.
Wow. Did you know that was what you wanted to do full-time, real estate?
I'm entrepreneurial by nature, so anything business or starting my own business, that's what I'm into. They
right.
did have actually a real estate club at Howard University.
Okay.
So I was a part of that club, so I did have a bug, if you would, for real estate, but I didn't know at that time that that's what I wanted to do full time. It was just something new
yeah.
and interesting. So when I took the class and it was just sort of jump right in, it was starting my own business,
mm-hmm.
right? I was in charge of everything,
mm-hmm.
and it was something new and exciting at the time. So originally, no,
yeah.
I didn't, but now that I'm in, I'm sort of glad I
yeah,
made that jump.
So you go with your decision.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
That's good.
Yeah.
So, Miss Young Homeowner, as you know, we're a platform that aims to educate and inspire
right.
millennials to get into real estate investing. How do you feel just in general about millennials and home ownership? A lot of statistics these days are saying millennials
oh, yeah.
aren't trying to buy homes and that's not our thing, but what is your take on that?
Right, so I see the articles all the time and I read every single one of them because how I feel, I think I'm sort of in a bubble,
mm-hmm.
right? Where if I look at my friends and family who are millennials, most of them, and it's true, most of them don't own their own homes,
yeah.
but just me being in the business, I see people our age buying homes all the time, right? Whether it's me or some of my friends who are agents who are helping them purchase their home. So when I read these articles, I have a lens which
right.
is saying, well, this is not true, because just last week I helped a buyer who
Absolutely.
Was 24, 25 purchase their first home, right?
Right.
So when I read those articles, I get it. I sort of see where they're coming from. I think there is a sort of bias towards it, where they're looking at specific cities where it really is that expensive to purchase a home. But I think from what I've read, I think there's a couple reasons why they think that. And it's valid,
yeah.
right? What it says is that, one, that home prices are steadily increasing, right? And of course, that's going to make it difficult for people to buy
mm-hmm.
as prices continue to increase. But two, one thing that I read, which I thought was interesting, is that millennials, as you know, we're not tied down to any specific location or job, right?
Right?
If there's
right.
an opportunity across the country,
we're ready to
take it, right? And that's valid.
Like, yeah,
I can appreciate
as we should.
That. Right.
Yeah.
So I think that's part of one of the reasons where it's not necessarily that we can't buy a home, but it doesn't really suit a lot of people's lifestyles.
Mm-hmm.
If they're not tied to a job, or if they're not comfortable where they are, they want to be able to get up and move.
Mm-hmm.
Now, personally, I think you can do that and own a home.
I agree.
And we can touch on that later. And we can touch on that
agree.
Later. So I don't necessarily take that as an excuse, but I can see why, I can see that perspective. Another thing that I read was that for millennials,
mm-hmm.
we are one, starting families later in life and getting married mm-hmm. later in life, right? So when you have those big life changes, that's when people typically say, now it's time to buy a house, right?
Let me settle down.
Exactly. Yeah. So if we're getting married later or purchasing home later, and you tie that to the fact that the longer we wait, the more expensive we become, millennials can be locked out of home ownership.
Makes sense. Yeah. I know a big thing that I've read is this whole student loan debt that mm-hmm. people, that millennials in particular, are finding themselves in. And I guess just by nature, if you think you have X amount of dollars in student loan, mm-hmm. you're not even thinking of purchasing or buying real estate.
Right.
Are a lot of your clients in that predicament? Do they have student loan that they're trying to overcome but still want to buy a home?
Right. And I challenge my anybody that I talk to, like my buyers or my clients or anybody who just wants to talk real estate and sort of brings that up, right? Because I have student loan debt. A lot of people that I know that I went to school with, of course, have student loan debt. I challenge them to challenge that notion, right? Because I think if you want to buy a home, and I'm proof, you can purchase a home with student loan debt. I've had clients do it. I've had plenty of people do it. You can.
Love
I'm going
to
say this
that.
To the camera. You can purchase a home with student loan debt. What lenders are looking at is not necessarily how much debt you have, but what are you paying on a monthly basis, and how does that compare to your quote unquote debt to income ratio?
Yes, we talked about this in season one. Your debt to income ratio.
Right. Debt to income ratio is mm-hmm. key. So they're looking at all your debts, not just your student loan, but your if you have a car loan, your credit card debt. Mm-hmm. So they're looking at the payments you make on that based on the money you make.
Right.
So that's sort of key. It's not necessarily how much student loans you have. It's what you're paying and how does that affect your whole financial story.
So takeaway, if you're listening and you have student loan debt, that shouldn't deter you
from wanting
to pursue home ownership.
Absolutely not.
Right?
And what a lot of people don't know is if you look at student loan debt, right, and the most, the people among us who have the most student loan debt are going to be the medical practitioners, right, because they're going to school for a lot longer, and your lawyers.
Right.
Lenders have specific programs for doctors, for nurses, and medical professionals where they realize that because of the industry that you're in, that you do have mm-hmm. a higher student loan debt, and there's specific loan programs to address those concerns.
Even for the not opposite spectrum, but even if you aren't in that profession, we just did a whole campaign on our social media about teachers.
Okay.
Just because it was back to school mm-hmm. month, and there are a bunch of programs for teachers to help them with down payment assistance.
Correct. Especially
and not
in
just
DC
teachers,
Maryland.
But just you know any mm-hmm. profession. We just say that to say any profession you
absolutely.
Can get help. So another thing that I wanted to just ask is, with your experience and your clients, some are first-time home buyers, I'm assuming,
correct.
Right?
A lot of first-time home buyers.
Okay, which is good. That's encouraging.
Oh, absolutely,
yeah. What are some of the hurdles and preconceived notions that they come to you with, or just some fears overall that they have?
I think number one is the amount that they would have to come out of pocket, right? And it's a valid concern. Everybody wants to know how much.
Everybody wants to know that.
Exactly. and it's a tough question to answer because there's so many moving parts. It really just depends on your specific situation.
Mm-hmm.
How much are you, one, how much are you comfortable coming out of pocket? Two, what's your price point, right? And then three, what can we negotiate with the lender, with the seller, and the other parties involved to make that number what you want it to be, right? And then how does that affect your monthly payments, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which I think is most important. It's the first thing when somebody comes to me and says, well, how much, what price should I be looking at? Well, first thing I say is, what are you comfortable paying monthly? Like, what are you paying now? Are you willing to go up a little bit? Or do you want to stay where you are at? Or maybe you want to pay a little less?
Yeah.
So I think that's the number one question that we have to figure out. And then we work backwards.
Yeah. Right? And it's tough because it is a valid question. Mm-hmm. And people want to know, okay, I want to buy a home, but how much do I need? Like, tell me the price. And it's well, it's not that simple.
Yeah,
exactly. There's all these other variables that come into play mm-hmm. to get that number.
Right. I've had clients come to the table with $10,000. I've had clients come to the table with $40,000. I've had clients come to the table with $5K and less. And it's possible, right? It just depends on your situation, what you're looking to buy, and what programs can we get to assist you with that.
Yeah. Okay. So another takeaway, it doesn't matter how much or how little you have, if you want to buy a home, you can do it, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, go for it. I mean, if it really is on your agenda and it's one of your goals, I would say go for it, because one, it doesn't hurt, right? Mm-hmm. It starts with having a conversation with a realtor and a lender, right? And both of those conversations are free. We're not going to charge for this information because we want to give it out to the people, right?
Okay. And so, speaking on par with that, let's say you do find your real estate agent, they hit you up, they call you, right? Cool. Call him. I know people have to go through this pre-approval, pre-qualification process. Sure. Can you just explain the difference between the two?
Right. So, there's a slight difference between being pre-qualified and being pre-approved, right? So, both involve you giving information to a lender. Mm-hmm. The difference is with a pre-approval, that information is verified, right? So, with a pre-qualification, you're on the phone with the lender and you're saying, look, I make this much, my expenses are this much, what can I purchase? And they're gonna give you a number, right? Mm-hmm. As a realtor, I can't really do anything with that information. It's good for you to have, because if you're saying, if you want a ballpark, right? And that's what people want. We're in that planning stage, they're 3 months, 6 months, maybe a year out. They want to know, like, where should I be looking? If I'm on these websites looking at homes, where I should be looking? That's what a pre-qualification is perfect for.
It gives you that number to play with.
Right, exactly, right. So, and it's not perfect. I can't take that number and bring it to a seller and say, hey, I have a buyer who, quote unquote, is pre-approved, because you're not approved yet, right? So when I say pre-approved is verified information, it's meaning that the lender is now looking at your pay stubs, your bank statements, and your W-2s, etc., to say what you're telling them is the truth, right?
Okay. If I get pre-approved for a $250,000 loan, is it in my best interest as the buyer to use all of that in finding a home?
It depends, right? So not typically when I'm working with a lender and they give me a pre-approval letter, I'll say, look, this is where they want to be, but they told me that they want their payments to be at, let's say, $1,500 a month. Is this what that number is? Okay. And they're going to tell me, no, this is her max. If she wants to be at $1,500 a month, she needs to go down, or hey, maybe, yeah, she can go up to this if she wants her payment to be that,
okay.
Right?
So it really is on that monthly mortgage.
I always go back to it, because that's the number one fear when people go into home ownership. They don't want to be stuck paying more than they can, right? Because then they're quote unquote house poor. Mm-hmm. They can't go out. They can't keep up the lifestyle that they had because they didn't calculate for that payment. So that's why I always go back to that monthly payment. But when it comes to the pre-approval, right, like you sort of alluded to, there's two numbers. There's your max. This is the max that I can afford. And two, this is what I would want to pay. This is a range that I want to be in. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's the same number, right? Yeah. Sometimes the max, and depending on the market that you're in, is what you can get and what the market is would be able to afford you. And maybe you're comfortable with payments around that price point. So the key is that I can't, and I won't go out to show somebody a property unless they're pre-approved. Okay. Because I don't want to show you property that you can't afford.
Yeah.
Right. It's sort of like you go into this. Right. It is. I mean, and it's not a good use of your time as a buyer. So I wait till you're pre-approved, and then I'll take you out to go see some of those homes.
So my realtor would never be able to show me a home like this. At least not right now.
Right.
At least not right now.
Exactly. So and pre-approval is key as well, because when we're submitting an offer, the seller wants to see that pre-approval letter. They want to make sure, they want to bulletproof the process, want to make sure that a buyer that I'm bringing them can afford this home. Yeah. And that's what a pre-approval does for you.
Okay, so kind of going off of that, this is a little sidestep
sure,
of what I said I would
let's go there.
But from the seller's perspective, what kind of work goes in on that front? Like, if I'm coming to you to sell my property, how involved am I versus how involved are you? What do you have to do on your end?
So when I'm working with sellers, I want to make sure that I'm carrying most of the weight, right? So they're going to be involved in the beginning of the process, and once we handle all the paperwork, as far as what their goals are and what they're looking to get out of it and what we need to do to help them reach those goals, then I take all the weight off of them, right? Because I only want to go back to them when I need a decision to make. I'm not going to make any decisions on behalf of the seller, but any offers that come in, I'm going to present to them, any challenges that may arise, and that they may need to know, I'm going to bring them in. But as far as the legwork, that's why I'm there for.
What kind of costs are associated with selling your home or selling a property?
Good question. It's a great question. So with all my sellers, I provide a seller net sheet, right? And a majority of your expenses is going to come from these couple places, right? So you have your taxes that you have to pay. Mm-hmm. When you anytime a property transfers hands,
right,
you have to pay a tax to the city, to the state. Mm-hmm. So that's where a majority of the expenses are going to go. You also have your title fees, which goes to the title company, and then of course you have to pay your realtor, right?
Okay.
So buyers, a lot of buyers don't know. The sellers are more familiar because they've purchased before, but as a buyer, you don't pay for the service of having a realtor. It's completely free. You never have to come out of pocket to pay me as your buyer's agent anything. Mm-hmm. I get paid for by the seller, right? Okay. So in reverse of that, if you are selling your property, you're responsible for not only your agent's compensation, but the agent that's bringing a buyer, responsible for their compensation as well.
I didn't know that. Wow. Right. Okay.
So,
I didn't know that.
So that's sort of where those costs are coming from. And what you'd want your agent to do is before you list a property, when you have an idea of what you're going to list it for, mm-hmm. have them run a seller's net sheet, right, which all agents should be doing, and then you'll get a sense of, okay, when I sell this property and I subtract what I owe on my mortgage, this is what I'm going to come out with.
Okay.
So it's no surprises. Wow.
Right? Good information. Yeah. I didn't mm-hmm. know that. All right, so we're sitting in this beautiful townhome.
Yes.
Okay.
Townhome style.
Condos. Just walk us through this luxurious.
Yeah, like, absolutely.
It's beautiful.
Yeah, so this condo is actually one of my team's projects. I'm part of the Mankiti Group, MG Residential. We have four arms to our business. One is a commercial arm.
Okay.
One is a development arm. Residential, where we help buyers and sellers, and then we also own the Keller Williams Capital Properties brokerage.
Oh, wow.
So our development arm, we work on single family homes, mm-hmm. where we'll go in to homes that need fixing up. We'll go in, redevelop it, and put it back on the market.
Okay.
And then we'll do the same for certain properties, what we call condo conversions. So
gotcha.
We'll take one property, turn them into two or three, put them back on the market.
Wow.
So, and this is one of our projects. So this is 410 K Street in Northeast. Two bedrooms, 2.5 bathrooms, two level condos.
Okay.
So it's two of them, and they're beautiful. 1,500 square feet is unit one. Unit two is 1,600 square feet.
Is unit two downstairs?
Unit two is
okay.
This, right.
Gotcha.
So unit two is the upper level. And what you'll see as soon as you walk in is the kitchen, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's massive,
mm-hmm.
right? So you have the beautiful island in the center. You have the waterfall island. You have your quartz countertop. And then, as sort of as you alluded to before, was the details, right?
Yeah.
So you have the gold accents, which I love. if you look around the side, you do have the blue cabinets, which sort of gives you that
pop of color.
Exactly. And then leading out goes to your dining room space and area.
Wow.
And then past that, as you go outside, you can step outside to your balcony or head upstairs where you have your shared rooftop.
Mm-hmm.
Coming this way, your first door is going to be your half bath.
Okay.
Yeah. So what I like about it is very inconspicuous. You don't really know it's there.
Know.
Right.
Yeah. I love those doors too.
Yeah, the doors are beautiful. And then as you come to this side, first thing you'll notice is the sunlight that you get from the huge windows. And as you walk up the stairs, you'll notice the same thing is
mm-hmm.
the plethora of sunlight that you get, and that's from the twin skylights that we have as you go upstairs. Upstairs is two bedrooms on opposite sides of the home, and then right in the middle you do have a den area, which
mm-hmm.
someone can use as an office space or lounge space, whatever. But
nice.
Very spacious upstairs, and beautiful.
Is the other unit the same layout? Is it a similar layout?
So similar layout in the fact that it does have two bedrooms and 2.5 bath. But when you go downstairs, the first level is going to be your kitchen.
Okay.
And then when you go down the stairs is where your bedrooms are located.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, this is beautiful.
Yeah.
So I wanted to get your take. We said earlier how people don't want to buy homes, or millennials, because they think buying a home equates to settling down
mm-hmm.
and it restricts them from taking a job in a new city. Like, what are your thoughts on that?
I disagree, right? I think it's actually the opposite. I think owning a home offers you more freedom than it would if you were renting, right?
Totally agree.
Because if it doesn't hinder you at all, right? I think with home ownership, if you decide to purchase a home and you want to move across the country, right? And let's say it didn't benefit you to sell at that specific time, you can always rent it out,
yeah.
right? You can rent it out for the amount that of your mortgage, and a lot of times you can get more, mm-hmm. right? Depending on how you structure that. Also, when you locked in a lease, right? It's typically a year lease. You can't leave until that lease is up, or else they're going to charge you for
exactly.
it, right? If you own your own home, and let's say you have a friend who needs a place to stay, a family member needs a place to stay, they can pay you yeah. whatever the mortgage is.
I think it gives you more flexibility.
It gives you way more flexibility.
Honestly.
Yeah. I think if you really align it apples to apples, I mean, you'd find that owning gives you more flexibility,
yeah.
to freedom to do whatever you want, go yeah. wherever you want to go.
So for people who are watching this, who are thinking about buying a home mm-hmm. in the next 3 months, 6 months, or even a year out, mm-hmm. what are some specific things you would tell them to start doing or preparing for?
Sure. Yeah, I recommend these four things to all my clients when they come to me, no matter where they are in the stage, right? Number one is going to be to boost your credit, right? Because it can't hurt, right? Even if you have a good credit, take a look and see how you can get that number even higher, because the higher your credit score, the lower your interest rate can be,
right?
Right? So you want to be in a position where you're able to work with your lender to get you the best terms as possible, mm-hmm. and having the highest credit score will help you do that. And what does that include? That means paying down your debts, right?
Mm-hmm.
Not necessarily getting your credit card balance to zero, but you wanna get a utilization rate that's around 15% or lower.
Less than 30%. We
right.
talked about this in season
absolutely,
two.
Absolutely, absolutely. So get your credit card utilization
yes.
rate lower. And then if you don't have credit and you're looking to build credit, get a secured credit card,
mm-hmm.
right? So there are a lot of options out there, and I'd recommend talking to a financial advisor, or even just going online and looking for some strategies and a way to
yeah.
boost your credit score. But that's one of the first things that I do recommend.
Okay.
Saving for the down payment and closing costs, right? If you don't have to know what that amount is in order to save,
yes.
right? Just
yes.
save.
Just save.
Right? Save. Find anything that you can put money here and there, and there's apps to help you if you're not good with saving. But that's the thing, right? As long as you have money put aside, it's not just a down payment and closing costs that you'd have to pay for, but it's after you move into the home, it's yours now,
oh my gosh.
Right? Yeah, and things
everything.
Happen, right?
It's
exactly.
Everything.
You can buy new, you can buy old. You're gonna have to do some sort of work to the property, because over time, things happen.
Yeah,
right.
It's inevitable.
Mm-hmm.
Every month, something has had to be fixed or whatever. And
been
I live
there.
In a new construction right. condo, so.
Right? So that's number three, right? So just put, after you've taken care of, let's say you have money put aside for down payment and closing costs, just put some away for rainy days,
rainy
right?
Day,
you just
yeah.
never know what's gonna happen. I've had some hiccups when I purchased and moved into my home that we had to take care of, and it was nice that we weren't strapping for
right.
cash, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because we had just me knowing
right.
better, just, hey,
yeah.
let's put some money aside just so we can
absolutely.
Take care of these things. And then number four, you can do a lot of the legwork now, right? And by legwork, I mean, look at properties, look at homes, go to open houses on Sundays, go online and look at properties, drive around neighborhoods just so you have a better idea of where you actually want to live,
mm-hmm.
right? You don't want to wait until you're out with a realtor to say, I actually don't like this neighborhood,
mm-hmm.
right? Drive around certain neighborhoods, go during the day, go
yeah.
at night, see what the traffic pattern is like.
Go on the weekends.
Go on the weekends.
Yeah.
Put the address in your GPS, get a sense of what that commute looks like,
mm-hmm.
right? Because if you're going to work
true.
To and from every day, you want to make sure that you're happy with what that looks
so
like.
True.
So those are a couple of things that you can do without a professional, right?
Okay.
You don't need a lender for those things. You don't need a realtor for those things. Just that's something you can do
yeah.
on your own.
And my last question, just mm-hmm. given the couple of years you've been in real estate,
sure.
being a black man, a millennial yourself, how do you feel like, I don't know, just in general, like being a realtor in DC,
mm-hmm.
like a nation's capital,
yeah.
do you feel that as black millennials, we're doing our due diligence and buying back into our neighborhoods and investing and setting up our families for generational wealth through real estate? Are you wishing there was more of that?
Right.
Like, in general, how
yeah,
are you
yeah.
feeling?
I have a good feeling about it. I think overall, I think there's a culture change where people are starting to see the importance of owning your own, right?
Yeah.
Not only real estate, but owning your own business. And for me, It's sort of inspiring, right? Because I'm in it every day, right? I see it. So articles can come out and TV shows and media can say one thing, but I see it every day, right? I'm helping us black, young black millennials, I'm helping us buy and sell, right? So I know that we are in the market. I do think that we can be in the market more, right? And it just starts with educating yourself, right? You have to want it. I never want to push somebody to home ownership if that's not on their goals, right? And that's perfectly okay.
Yeah, that's fair.
Right? If you're not interested in owning a home, but at least I would say check it out, right? Don't say that you can't. Anybody can be pre-approved. I mean, you may be pre-approved for $80,000, but now at least we know where you are.
Exactly.
It's just a roadmap, right? You don't wake up on Monday and decide to buy a house on Friday. It's a roadmap.
Yeah.
It's a plan
Anybody
that you have to put in place.
Anybody can be pre-approved.
I like that.
That's a good takeaway.
Absolutely. Yeah. So it's not like, hey, I won't be pre. No, you will.
It doesn't hurt to see where you stand.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right. Okay. So I'm very hopeful. I'm very hopeful. I think more people can get educated about not only just owning for themselves, but investing in property. And as far as buying back the block, in some neighborhoods, I mean, let's be honest, it's too late, right? In some of these neighborhoods, I mean, gentrification is happening rapidly, right? And it happens overnight. I'll tell you, if I could have purchased near where I was living, near my school and Howard University, I would have.
Yeah.
I can't now,
yeah.
right?
Yeah,
so
true.
If I knew what I knew now, back then when I was going to school, I was living in a home, right? Because a couple of my friends decided to rent out. Mm-hmm. We could have easily purchased something in that neighborhood.
Yeah.
And now those homes are going for $1 million, right?
Right?
Yeah. 800K plus, where if I knew what I knew now, I would have tapped in every resource. All right, well, ask your parents what they can give us. You ask your parents. And that's what I recommend people do now.
Yeah.
You don't have to do it by yourself, right? If you want to purchase a home and you don't have a significant other or boyfriend, girlfriend or whatever, grab a friend. Hey, let's do this together, right? You're living here and you're paying X amount. I'm living here paying X amount. Let's come together, purchase a home, right? We save money and then we're able to get into the market, and with the market comes equity and appreciation, right?
I love that strategy, pulling your resources together, making something happen.
Absolutely.
All right, so where can the people find you if they have questions?
Yes, if you have questions, I mean, I'm available on Instagram. You can follow me at danielwalcott.realtor. I'm also on Facebook. I'm also on Twitter. You can find me anywhere. I mean, text me. You're right. You know what I mean? Like, I love talking real estate, right? So I'm always willing to help and provide any insight and value that I can for anybody.
Well, thank you for being here. We appreciate
Thank you for having
it.
Me. Thank you.
Stay tuned to the rest of our season and all of our episodes, and we hope that you learned something. And let us know if you have questions. We'll see you next time.
All right.